Good morning. Good morning. Welcome. Welcome to church. And good morning, or good afternoon, or good evening, whatever time of day it happens to be when you're watching online at home or on the DVDs. And to those who are listening on the CD, good morning and welcome to you too. And we've got some visitors with us this morning, I see, which I'm very pleased to see. We are going to be having a cup of tea, coffee after the service, so please do come and join us afterwards. That would be lovely. Thank you. We'll just have a wee look at this week's church family news to begin with. If you would like a copy of this, they're on the table by the door, by the way. Usual reminders that Monday prayers take place at 8 in the morning and 6:30 in the evening tomorrow, Monday, of course. And then, of course, there's coffee and company on Tuesday from 10 until 12. And now that the school holidays are unfortunately over for the summer, the Well Cafe is back this Friday. The Well Cafe is back this Friday. It's on from 9:15 to 11:15 in the morning. And, well, while it's mostly mums and their preschool children who come along, everyone is welcome. Dads, grannies, granddads, everyone's welcome. You don't even have to bring a child with you. But it is helpful. So that's Friday morning at 9:15. And looking just a wee bit further ahead, you'll have seen it on screens already. The Guild is almost ready to begin its new session, the first one since it closed down for the pandemic. And the first meeting is going to be at 2 p.m. on Tuesday, the 6th of September, here in the Church Centre, and the speaker will be Rosie Campbell from Home for Good. And Home for Good is one of the charities that the Guild is currently supporting, and it's a Christian charity which is all about finding homes for children through fostering or adoption. And they work with the church to welcome and help these families and support them along the way. So that's the 6th of September at 2 o'clock, and everyone's welcome, whether you're a member of the Guild or not. Please come along. Now, I did say just a minute ago that the school holidays are over for this year, and our weekly prayer topic, well, it's based around going back to school. Proverbs 22:6 says, "Teach a child how he or she should live, and they'll remember it all their life." So in your prayers this week, we would ask you just to pray for each child, each young person, for the teachers, for everyone else who works in our schools. May they be granted patience and understanding as they work together, and may they be given God's blessings and protection. I've just one more thing to mention this morning, actually, and that's just to mention that I won't be with you next Sunday. I'm taking the service in Foggy for a wee change. Lillian Brown will be here with you next week, and I'm sure that you'll all give her a really warm welcome. Let's begin our worship for this morning then, shall we? And we'll begin by singing a lovely, lovely, peaceful song to begin with, "Be Still for the Presence of the Lord." Stand or sit as you wish.
Thank you.
So let's come to him in prayer now. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come here this morning and in our homes too, some in the morning and others throughout the week, we come with a purpose in mind, and that's to feel your presence among us. We still ourselves. We open our hearts and our minds, ready to welcome you among us. And as we welcome your presence, Father, we offer you our praise. Praise for all that you are, all that you've ever been, all that you'll always be. We give you our thanks too. Thanks for all that you've given us, all you continue to give us. We praise you even though we don't see you. We see your work all around us, though, as the seasons change, as the sun rises and sets in the fields, as the harvest begins to be brought in and on the streets of our towns and villages. We don't see you in person, but we see you reflected in the eyes of our family and friends, and we see you in the interactions we have with strangers. You see us, though, and you surround us, but you never crowd us out. You give us space, you give us room to breathe, you give us the scope to live our lives in our own ways, even if sometimes we live them in the wrong ways. Father, you've given us so much more than we deserve, and you just ask that we love you in return and follow the paths that you've given us to tread. But for the times when we fail to follow in your footsteps, we ask for your forgiveness. For the times when we fall short of what you expect of us, we're sorry. For the times when we see enemies and friends through different lenses instead of with the same loving outlook, forgive us. You've given each of us everything we need to make the world all it's meant to be, all that you mean it to be, from showing kindness and offering help to those who need it, to forgiving others who've hurt us. So help us today and every day to remember that. Help us to be more like your Son, who you sent to teach us how to live and to love each other, how to forgive each other, and who taught us the prayer that we say together now. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. The kingdom, power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Now, this won't apply to some of you, because I know that we have quite a few visitors in this morning, but to those of you who are here most Sundays, some of you are here every Sunday, I wonder how well you know your church centre. Those of you who are watching at home, if you've been here, you can maybe play along with this too. If you haven't been here, and I know that some of you haven't, well, just go and make a cup of tea or something. I'm going to show you some pictures of parts of the church centre here, and you've got to tell me what they are, what the picture is of. Easy. If you're struggling with any of them, I can give you a skiff. Do you know what a skiff is? My sisters are here this morning. They know what a skiff is. In Port Soy, you think of a skiff as a sailing boat, but a skiff where I'm from is it's a clue in I Spy. If you're struggling to know, you know, if a TV screen, you can ask for a skiff and I'll go like that to point towards it. You see a skiff? There you go. So if you're struggling with any of these, just ask for a skiff and you can have one. Here's the first one. What's that? We're all pointing upwards. Yep, it's the roof, the decals on the roof, yep. They do get more difficult than this. Next one, Anne, thank you. What's that? Well, somebody's pointing up with me. Yvonne, you're pointing up with me? Anyone? Oh, yep, we're pointing across, yep. Well done, it's the rails along the side there. The teak bit, yeah. Okay, next one, thank you. Yep. Yeah, it's a cap on the stair post there. Yeah. Next one. Now we're looking confused. Emma? Yes, press here for the fire alarm. Push here, there you go. Very good. We can and the next one. What's that now? We've got a few people turning around and pointing. Yep. It's Jesus' feet in Doreen Cummings' tapestry of the Last Supper that's behind us over there. Next one. I told you these are getting more difficult. Now. Do you need a skiff for this one? I'll give you a skiff, shall I? We're all looking round. I think I've got you in this one, haven't I? I think I've got you here. It's one of the coat hooks in the lobby, underneath. I know, that's not very fair. Here's the next one. What's that? Any ideas? What are you thinking, Fiona? You're pointing at something? Oh, okay, you're really close. You're really, really close. No? Well done, Yvonne. Yep, it's a bottle of water. Taken like that. I told you they're getting more difficult. We've got one more. What's that? Well, it's obviously a hinge, isn't it? Yeah. This is a bit of a cheat, actually. It's a bit of a cheat because it's a hinge in the door behind me here. There you go. Bit of a cheat. Okay. So these are all things that are out in plain sight. The photos or the angles of the photos might make them just look a bit unfamiliar, but we can still see them all in here, except for the last one, the hinge on the door there, but I had to catch you out with at least one of them. You've got to open the door to see that one. Anyway, the reason I played that game this morning is because, well, last week I spoke about hearing God by tuning into him like we do with a radio, or tuning out the things that distract us, and by reading his word. But what I'm going to be talking about later this morning is about seeing him, is about seeing God. I'm going to give you a spoiler alert right now, because I'm not going to tell you how we can actually see God with our eyes. If I could do that, I wouldn't be here. If I could do that, I don't think any of us would be here. We can't see God physically. It's not like seeing these things in the pictures, seeing the things around us. It's not like just opening a door there to see the things that are hidden. But what I'll be talking about is how we can maybe see God in our lives. So we'll come to that in a wee while. But first, we'll sing our next hymn. And our next hymn is Immortal, Invisible.
Thank you.
We come now to our Bible readings for this morning, and Paul is going to read for us this morning. Thanks, Paul.
Our first reading is from the second book of the Bible, and this is what it says. And the Lord said to Moses, "This very thing you have spoken I will do, for you have found favor in my sight, and I know you by name." Moses said, "Please show me your glory." And he said, "I will make all my goodness pass before you and will proclaim before you my name, the Lord. And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show mercy on whom I will show mercy." But he said, "You cannot see my face, for man shall not see me and live." And the Lord said, "Behold, there is a place by me where you shall stand on the rock. And while my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft of the rock, and I will cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will take away my hand, and you shall see me from my back, but my face you shall not see." And then in the New Testament, let's find it. Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father, and it is enough for us." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you so long, and you still do not know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works." "Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me, or else believe on the account of the works themselves. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than those will he do, because I am going to the Father. Whatever you say in my name, this will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me for anything in my name, I will do it." Amen.
Amen, yeah, amen. God bless the reading of his word this morning. Let's sing again. Our next hymn now is "Great is Thy Faithfulness."
Thank you.
I'm sure I've mentioned before, but one of the things that I've not managed to do here in Port Sawyer as yet is to see the dolphins. I thought I did once. Last year I was out in the East Breeze and I saw them, or what I thought was them, away in the distance. And I watched for ages, 20 minutes, half an hour. I took some pictures, I zoomed in as far as I could. And it was only when I got home and zoomed in even more on pictures on my computer and on a bigger screen, and I realized that I'd been watching rocks for about 20 minutes. There's no dolphins at all. I'll see them one day. The same with the Northern Lights. There was a good display the other night there, apparently. Missed it. Last winter, I got one of these apps on my phone that tells you when's a good time to see them, but it still didn't help. I'd get the notification on my phone, I'd get my coat on, I'd head out to the West Breeze, but nothing. Some things you can only see when the time's right, when you happen to be in the right place at the right time. And we heard Paul reading from Exodus earlier on about a time when Moses hoped that he was in the right place at the right time, the right place and the right time to see God. Only it didn't turn out to be quite as simple as that. The place is the desert, and the time is when Moses and his people, the Israelites, are wandering in it, making their slow way towards the promised land. And they carry a tent with them, and that's where they go to, where Moses goes to converse with God, to speak with God. A pillar of cloud appears outside the tent, and the voice of God comes from inside the cloud. But for Moses, this is not quite enough. He wants more. He wants to actually see God. "Show me your glory," he says. "Show me your glory." Moses wants some kind of certainty about the situation that they're in. God had freed his people from Egypt, and they'd been wandering in the desert for years. God had fed them. He'd sent them quails and manna and fresh water. But when it all came down to it, Moses and his people were essentially homeless. They'd come from Egypt, where they'd been slaves, and they'd moved on from there, but they had no idea of their future. All they had to go on was God's provision for them and his promise that better days would lie ahead. Moses and his people had a destination, a land flowing with milk and honey, they'd been told. But at this time, at this point, they feel farther away from it than ever. So I don't think you can really blame Moses for asking for some reassurance, can you? Because he's leading a nervous, frightened people. He wants to give them reassurance. So in effect, what he's doing is he's saying to God, "Just give me a wee bit more. Just give me some more. I know we talk as if we're face to face, but let's do it literally face to face, just so I can lead my people with a bit more confidence. Show me your glory," he says. "Show me your glory." So God does give something to Moses. Not everything that Moses wants, but something. And I'll just read it again. "I will make all my goodness pass before you, and I will proclaim before you my name. But you cannot see my face and live. There's a place by me where you shall stand on the rock, and when my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft of the rock, and I will cover you with my hand till I have passed by. Then I will take away my hand, and you shall see my back, but my face shall not be seen." So this is how it happens. Moses, God walks by, and with his hand, he covers the opening in the rock where Moses is. And then when he passes by, he takes his hand away, and Moses just sees his back. I'm always saying that the truth of what actually happened, how it happened, and if it happened, is an awful lot less important than the message we're given through it. So what's the message? What's the message here? First of all, I think we know that God is with Moses. And God listens to him. He responds to him. And next, we know that Moses sees the hand of God. Maybe it reminds him that the hand of God is in what God did and what he continues to do for his people. And we know that God shows Moses his back. Maybe God showing him his back means that he's trying to tell him that he's moving ahead of him and his people. He's leading them onwards. You can only see your leader from behind. And I think we need to know these things too. We need to know that God listens, that he responds. Like, you can think of all sorts of examples. Like, for example, when we're faced with illness or with loss, we have to know that God is there with us, listening and responding. When we go through financial worries, maybe, we have to know that God hears us and he responds to us. When it's 2 o'clock in the morning and we can't sleep because of whatever's going round and round in our heads, we've got to know that God's there if we reach out to him. And we have to know that God is out there leading us forward too. We don't know what tomorrow's going to bring, do we? But just now we can look ahead to all sorts of things. We can look ahead to rising prices, economic uncertainty, political turmoil, wars and conflicts. We can look ahead to uncertain times for our church here in Scotland, to unions and links, maybe even closures in some places. We can look ahead to a changing world in terms of climate, to resources becoming scarcer and scarcer. We can look ahead to inequality of wealth. But we need to know that through all this, God still has a way ahead for us. He's walking ahead, and he will lead us through it. Moses needed to hear that. So do we. We need it too. I think there is something else, though, that Moses, seeing the back of God as he passed by, tells us. And it's that we can sometimes see God best by looking back, by seeing where he's been when he passed by. I mentioned skiffs earlier on. Well, what about the boat kind? Let's talk about the boat kind. I'm no sailor, but even I know, everybody knows, if you look out at the back of a boat, the stern, you'll see the wake the boat leaves. You know that the boat's moving forward by looking out the stern, out the back. If the wind's light and you look out the front, it might seem like you're the bow, is it? The bow? See, I'm learning about sailing. If you look out the bow, it might seem like you're barely moving, but look out over the stern and you'll see the swirls and the eddies that tell you that you're moving forward. Or if you're, another example, if you're walking in the snow, you can't see your progress until you look back and see your footprints. We can't physically see God, not even his hand or his back, not like Moses did, but like the wake of a boat, like footsteps in the snow, we can see where he's been. We can see where, just to take the words that he said to Moses, where his glory passed by. All of our lives are different. We've all gone through different experiences, we've all followed our own paths, but I'm sure that all of us, every one of us, can all look back to a time when God's glory passed by. The birth of a child that you've waited seemingly forever for. The comfort of a friend during a time of loss. Finding your home in a new place. The smile of a stranger just when you needed it most. All signs of the glory of God passing by. All proof that he was there when you needed him. So much we don't know in life. So much we don't know. We don't know why some suffer and some just seem to sail through life. We don't know why bad things happen to good people. We don't know what lies ahead for us. Knowing these things just isn't possible, like seeing God isn't possible. But we do know that he's with us, listening to us, responding to us. And we know that he's ahead of us, leading us forward. And we can see where he's been, where his glory passed by. In the New Testament reading Paul gave us, Philip said, "Show us the Father and it's enough for us." To which Jesus said, he said, "Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or else believe on account of the works themselves." The works. The works are the proof of where Jesus had been, where he'd passed by, of what he'd done. And as he and the Father are one and the same, that means where God had been, what he'd done, where his glory had passed by. Jesus left the sick cured. He left the lame walking, the blind seeing. He left those who'd lived sinful lives forgiven. He left the hungry fed. He left the mourners consoled. He left the weak strong. He left the outcast loved and welcomed. He did all that and much, much more. And we are encouraged. We are encouraged to do the same, to be like him, to leave good things behind us. So I've said all along this morning that we can't see God, not physically. But I can't come to an end without saying in this life. Because there is the promise of seeing him in the next. We can take the words of Revelation 22, verse 4. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. But of course, there are conditions attached. We've got to believe. And our works, the proof of where we've been, what we've done, well, they won't be enough to make it possible, but we are still expected to leave our mark on the world in a good way. Maybe one day I'll see the dolphins. Maybe one night I'll be walking on the west breeze and the sky will suddenly be ablaze with the northern lights. Right place at the right time. Maybe one day I'll see God. I'm in no rush though. I'm more than happy to wait. And while I do, well, I'm going to do the best that I can to leave good things wherever I go. What can I say? I hope you do the same. Amen. We have some music on video now. It's quite, the words are very good. It's quite upbeat and loud. So stand if you wish, stay seated if you wish. Just please yourselves, just enjoy. I see you.
God of all glory, every day I see new mercy. child, I am with you. Everything will be all right. I see you in the morning.
Let's pray again, shall we? Let's pray. Father God, we don't see you, not yet anyway, but we see the good things that you do all around us. We do live in a world, though, that's come far from the one that you created it to be. You gave us the will to do as we wished with it, and through the years and the centuries, well, we've made it into one that's far less than perfect. So in this imperfect world, we find ourselves coming back to you, asking that you would help us to make it better, to make it good again. Father, we've so much to be thankful for. We're fortunate in so many ways. It's too easy, though, for us to take all that we've got for granted, to look inwards at ourselves instead of outwards towards the world, though. Because when we do look out, we ask ourselves, what can we do? We look out and we think it's all out of our control, but we look out and we know that all we can do is bring our prayers to you. So that's what we do. We pray for those in war-torn countries like Ukraine. It's not only Ukraine, of course, but so much attention is still focused there. We ask that you would give hope to those who've had their lives torn apart, their homes decimated, their freedom taken away. We ask you to speak to them through their pain and their turmoil. Let them know that you're with them, that you care about them, and that you can protect them. Pray for those under the cosh, under hard regimes, who are persecuted for their beliefs, for their gender, for their sexual orientation, asking that you would comfort them with the knowledge that people do care, that you care. We pray for those closer to home who are just worried by rising fuel bills, by cost of living increases that their incomes can't keep up with. And we ask that you just see into the hearts of those who can do something to help, whether they're politicians or power brokers, encouraging them to put protection before profit, well-being before wealth generation. Encourage them towards compassion, Father. Pray for those who are concerned by their health or the health of someone close to them, whether through diabetes, dementia, muscular dystrophy, motor neuron, any number of conditions and illnesses. We ask that you would give them strength to cope. Give them the hope that cures may bring, or at the very least that you can comfort them. And Father God, we give to you, and just in a moment of silence, those that we need, those we know that are in need of your special kind of care and comfort right now, or we just bring to you anything else that's on our minds. Father, having prayed for others, now we We bring ourselves to you. We give ourselves to you. We ask you to be with us as we go forward into the week. Come alongside us. Walk with us. Remain with us this week and always. Amen. So I spoke earlier on, mentioned just a few times in my talk earlier on about seeing the glory of God passing by. There's only one hymn we could really sing then, which would round things off. Mine eyes have seen the glory. Now may the Lord bless us and guard us. May the Lord make his face shine on us and be gracious to us. May the Lord look kindly on us and give us peace.